I think folks are excited to see you.
Yeah. We have a turnout.
We do have a turnout. Hello, all. Thank you for coming indoors to talk about the outdoors.
That's right.
Yeah, I just wanted to point that out there. Nick, I wanted to start by addressing the elephant in the room here.
Okay.
Class, if you can please turn your page to 247 of the book. It says that Big Bend is smelly. And I'm wondering if there's something you want to tell me.
Might you be making a generalization? Is that a direct quote? Do I say Big Bend is smelly?
I think you do, yeah. Okay, let me.
I think I might be referring specifically to a very small region of a gorgeous, beautiful smelling park.
Okay, mm-hmm.
Specifically the parking lot where the RVs are parked.
Yeah, you said plumbing ghost, specifically.
What I call plumbing ghosts are floating about that region.
Okay. Just wanted to throw that out there and give you a moment to let me know.
Yeah, in fairness, I think there's a lot of praise of our National Park Service and its beautiful environs. And I just wanted to be fair and balanced and...
Yeah, that's fair.
...include some minor admonitions.
Yep. Mm-hmm. I just wanted to start there. No. It has been a pleasure to read this book. So, for those who have not read it, you write about your experiences in the outdoors and you break it down into an experience with friends, experience cultivating the land, and experience with your wonderful wife. And so, we are reading your experiences now in the outdoors, and my question to you is, thinking back to one of your first experiences in the outdoors, how has your perspective changed since then? What has been like one of the biggest differences?
My friend Wendell Berry gave me the homework assignment to compare the point of view of John Muir to the point of view of Alda Leopold, who's an agrarian from Wisconsin, sort of the John Muir of Wisconsin, if you will, or to sort of color him because he's lesser known. Because I read a lot of agrarian writers, I was more well-versed in the Alda Leopold side of things.
Yep.
And I had never really, I love to hike, I love to be outside anywhere,
yeah,
but especially if there are trees. I'd never given myself the gift of just a week of like hiking in a national park.
Mm.
And so my book opens with hiking with two friends in Glacier National Park. And, you know, being out in these incredible landscapes and talking, and we had a guide who had a lot of great history to share. That's where my perspective changed incredibly, because at first you get the superficial reaction of, oh my God, this is the most beautiful place I've ever seen.
Yeah.
And it's made so much more special because it's just like it's always been. There's no people here. It's just the wildlife. And the guy, the guide said, oh, there used to be people here. But when the Europeans arrived, we took our squeegee and removed the people from these landscapes so that we privileged folks could hike and eat Cliff Bars. And so I realized, like so many issues in our modern civilization, it's a very complicated perspective. There is a lot to be said for treating the outdoors in that sensibility, but there's also a lot of problems that come with it.
Yeah, absolutely. So you actually bring up someone that I wanted to talk about, John Muir, who is a very complicated man. And throughout your book, you talk about nuance, and that is such a good word to describe John Muir. A lot of people can quote him, and we have learned a lot about the outdoors through him, which is great. And also, we're learning that he has erased people from his writing. So how do we ensure that everyone is at the table and that we include everyone when it comes to the outdoors?
Well, I mean, with the outdoors or with any public subject, I think that first and foremost, to continue to celebrate and espouse books, it's a news story right now that, you know, that truth is in question, you know, mm-hmm. that facts and science are being held in the balance are these facts that we're being told on television, are they true, or if we don't like them, should we accept them? And so, for me, having things categorically written down in books and fully researched and repeatably proven to be, you know, true or false, is paramount. And so when it comes to including everyone in a conversation like what to do with our public lands, for example, in the case of the legacy of John Muir or all of the other white guys mainly who you know, led troops to victory or suffered defeat in our Civil War or dealt with any of the myriad other topics that plague us these days, is to remember that they require nuance and that they're all human. Many of us, given the context of the time and place, would say, "Okay, yeah, that sounds good. That sounds like a good plan.
Right.
You're gonna get us that land, and then we can feed everybody. That sounds good. Oh wait, what's that? You have to kill a bunch of people, or you have to destroy the watershed,
right.
or you have to explode the top off a mountain so that we can have this light and air conditioning? Hang on."
Right.
And so, you know, I think the secret, let's say that there are statues of people that fought in the Confederate army.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
I think it's very important to pay attention to you know, the people that has a very deleterious effect on.
Mm.
But I also think it's very important to continue to inform ourselves of the whole story,
yep.
so that we don't forget why it's bad, or if we're taking a statue down, why is that?
Yep.
Can we continue to learn from that history lesson, even though we've removed the statue?
Yeah.
So it's, you know, just let's keep talking about it, and remember, we're a human society making mistakes. We'll always keep making mistakes because we love Twinkies.
They are actually kind of delicious.
They're mm-hmm. they're a great treat.
They really are. On the trail? Okay.
Forget about it. And guess what? They're not going to go bad.
Exactly. 30 days on the trail, that Twinkie's going to be...
Yeah.
I get it.
And so, but they also might be problematic in some ways.
Yeah.
I've crunched the numbers on this.
Oh, okay.
And so if we can keep having these conversations, we can always continue to strive toward doing a better job.
Yeah, I can appreciate that. I'm up here representing an entire government agency, and our history is very, very complicated. A lot of the land that we are protecting, maybe we didn't take it in the best or nicest way. And when we first started protecting lands, we would feed bears. We would actively tell folks to feed bears, and now, you know, stay as far away. So continuing to learn and look into our academics and science and make good decisions, I think is super important. Yeah.
Sure, there's some great stories that Aldo Leopold writes about in his career. He started out in the mountains of New Mexico, and it was our government policy to eradicate the apex predators.
Yep.
So it was just a thing. If you saw a wolf, you would shoot the wolf.
Yeah.
And eventually they killed all the wolves, and then the deer became overpopulated, mm-hmm. and they destroyed all the shrubbery,
mm-hmm.
through overeating. And, you know, we learned the hard way that nature has spent a long time figuring out the right balance,
right.
and the right recipe so that the whole ecosystem can be healthy. And when we come in and kill all the rabbits off, suddenly we're plagued with a carrot epidemic. That I may be paraphrasing, but
No, I think you got it.
I think that's accurate.
Yeah, that is accurate, yeah. Yeah, we want to put everything in nice, square, neat boxes and call it wilderness, that it's untrammeled. Yeah. And we are erasing thousands of years of human history of people who have known how to balance the ecosystem and live with it, like a symbiotic relationship.
Yeah, I talk about a book, I'm going to blank on the writer's name, but there's a great Australian book from 4 or 5 years ago called Dark Emu, and it very neatly describes this dilemma. When the Europeans arrived in Australia, they found the Aborigine to be a nuisance, and they completely discounted them and just wanted to remove them, which they did in a lot of brutal ways. And there was a lot of evidence of civilization and of centuries and millennia of learning to live in a sustainable way,
right,
with what Mother Nature provided. And of course, I'll say us, we smarty pantses showed up with European farming and European grazing animals, and everything died. And
then you were shocked.
And then we said, oh shoot, where did those people go that were growing? What were those rutabagas? And of course it was too late. And so that's a common, human dilemma, that we greedily destroy what we think we don't need, only to discover that that we really could use that knowledge.
Yeah. So, I was joking with you that you wrote that Big Bend, a specific section of Big Bend is smelly. And so now we are at this place where we have made the straight lines and we're protecting these places and calling them national parks. And we need to ensure that we protect these places forever. There's things like climate change, but that also means bringing more people into the outdoors. Mm-hmm. So I think part of the reason maybe that specific campground was smelly was because more people were using it. So how do we engage folks living in living in cities, or who maybe don't have the resources like time and money to start thinking about engaging in the outdoors in a different way?
Well, that's a great question, and that's one of the questions at the heart of my book, and I think of at the heart of what Wendell was asking me to write about, and that is to take the sensibility of the grandeur of nature, what we love about the parks. And this kind of gets to the heart of it, the John Muir sensibility. When I think of John Muir, I think of this heroic figure standing astride El Capitan in Yosemite or like hollering at me from the bottom of the Grand Canyon. And there's a sense of distance. And epic journeying, like the outdoors is a place that the Sierra Club has gone out of its way to provide me with a flight package, so that you have to travel to the outdoors, and
right,
you need gear and you need planning and you need all kinds of expenditure. And what Aldo Leopold is driving at is that we are, If we got our shovels out, it would take a while, but there's actually soil beneath us,
mm-hmm,
eventually, and that we're all living in nature at all times. And if you don't have nature in your immediate sphere, it's pretty easy to create some, whether it's growing a garden on your windowsill or keeping small animals or what have you, or cultivating a hardwood lot so that you can build Windsor chairs is an idea that springs to mind. But whatever that is, it's taking this sort of fabricated American sense of the outdoors in capital letters and shrinking it down to a local version, where instead we understand that we all live in a piece of the outdoors wherever we are, and that we all need to get cool with Mother Nature, not just with the owls in Oregon that we're saving or the trees that we're saving, but with our own watersheds. How are we treating the nature here in Washington, D.C.? I live in Los Angeles. where there should not be a city. mm-hmm. And so that's something that we're dealing with. We're like, well, geez, we stole the Colorado River for many decades. Now that's over. Now what? Warner Brothers, what's your next big idea? You know, Matt Damon is not returning my calls. I'm like,
keep trying.
I know you're helping with water in Africa. What about Bel Air, man? We're thirsty. So I mean, that's what I suggest to people. There's an incredible menu, and with the internet, you can find it very quickly in your area. Go to the garden center, go to the lumber yard, go to the craft center, and talk about who's making stuff in your neighborhood, and you'll find somebody is growing a whole forest of mm-hmm. beautiful trees in a tiny plot, you know? Mm-hmm. And coming to understand that, now, the thing that got me started on this is reading Wendell Berry, and he always posits the question, and Michael Pollan was also inspired by Wendell, to ask the question, what do you know about your food? Like, we all need food and sustenance every day, but so few of us know where it comes from or who provided it and how they produced it. And because we don't know that, in the same way that we give our agency to power companies, we give them our money and we say, I assume you're going to be cool with, you know, how you're going to send me my gasoline or my right. electricity. You're not going to be a dick, right? I can't imagine you would be a jerk to Mother Nature. And the same way, we give our dollars to food corporations without ever holding them to task of, like, are you actually doing what's the healthiest thing for me, your consumer, and the animals and the plants and the ecosystem in which you're creating this food? And so that was a big wake-up call. That's what got me writing and right. interested in this. And so all of those things, you know, go talk to people at your local farmer's market and find out what grows well here and what doesn't.
Yeah.
And then move to where blueberries grow well all the time.
Yeah. Pro tip, or plot twist, those companies probably are destroying Mother Nature. They're just like shitting on her. I probably shouldn't say that in my uniform. Oh my God.
We can beep that. You know what? It's time to bring some hard truth to the service.
What? No, I am shocked. I am surprised. Tell me more. There's a couple threads on there that I want to pull. I, first of all, not that I should advertise for the Park Service because I know everyone loves it, but there are 400 national parks in the United States. And we preserve and conserve a lot of different stories, the American people's story, the really hard stories, like concentration camps, to beautiful landscapes like Acadia. And there is something for everyone. It's just about getting folks excited. And so when I engage someone in the outdoors, I like to say that success isn't about everyone here starting to wear this uniform, because it is cute, right? But it's like not flattering. Thanks. Yeah. Success is about you having such a great experience in your outdoor space, whatever that space is, that you tell someone about it so that you can maybe go find that blueberry and maybe get excited about farming or maybe get excited about art in nature in all of the different ways. So I just wanted to throw that out there on that one.
Thank you. I am so grateful. I mean, we were talking backstage, some of us, just with the sort of superheroic effect your uniform has. Park rangers are dope as hell. Like,
thank you. Yep. Mm-hmm.
You are the curators of the majesty we're talking about, and it really covers the gamut. You know, people in recent years have done great books and film projects where they go to visit all the national parks.
Right.
And it's astonishing, the range of landscapes and terrains and natural beauty that we can see. I don't know, I'm going to be controversial here. I don't give a shit what's on Mars. I don't, like, there are a lot of hungry people. There are a lot of problems that could use funding.
Right.
And I don't need to take a joyride outside the atmosphere. I also drive the speed limit, so I may be in the minority. But I mean, the Park Service is one of the places, and the whole Department of the Interior, where I think it's becoming more and more clear we need more funding, we need more help, we need more great heads and personalities and energies like yours. I do like a blueberry myself.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But the whole point of this subject matter is to ideally, in the most idealized version of this, you go where the blueberries are. Mm-hmm. And of course, you can now, I mean, we can grow things in different climates using greenhouses and vertical gardens and whatnot. But generally, if you have to ship your produce from South America,
right,
it's not good. It's not helping.
Right.
Is the point. And so, if I have to be made to like some other kinds of berries, I will take it into consideration.
We're in D.C., so it's a swamp. I don't know what we're gonna grow here.
Cranberries, I think.
Yeah.
Are we too far south for cranberries?
Anyone know?
Yeah.
Oh,
shoot.
Yeah. I think we're just gonna eat like weird plants.
Mushrooms is what we're growing.
Oh, okay. Yeah. No, it's just gonna weird plants.
And then mushrooms are savory and also can make colors look really pretty. I think that's John Muir. I think that's.
Yeah.
John
no,
Muir.
I think you nailed it. Yeah, that is John Muir. Another thread that I wanted to pull from your previous statement: recreating in the outdoors. So I'm going to say something to you that might shock you, but I am brown.
Okay.
I am a person of color.
I'm glad I was sitting.
Yeah, I honestly didn't know if you were going to take it. And recreating in the outdoors for me is weird, even as a park ranger. The community of the outdoors sometimes feels gated, like there's a gatekeeper there, where I'm not supposed to be there, like my shoes aren't the right shoes, or like my hike isn't long enough, like I'm not stoked enough to be out there. But I would say that the way that I recreate is totally fine and okay.
Sure.
So how do we like get folks to understand that it's cool to do whatever you're excited about in the outdoors?
That's a great question, and something I'm glad you brought up, because it's a perspective that I'm literally, I tick all the wrong boxes. Middle-aged, white, cis, at least I'm ex-Catholic. That's, but I mean, I'm literally in the seat of privilege when it comes to that kind of perspective.
Yeah.
And so what's important is exactly what just happened, is for you to get onto this stage and say that, and for that to happen in all walks of life. I mean, in one of my other loves, woodworking, that's also a place where it's strangely Caucasian.
Mm-hmm.
But I think everybody uses furniture.
I think so, yeah.
From what I've read. and so it's something that I think, again, we need to continue to have a growing awareness and a sense of representation of, like, at my wood shop in Los Angeles, I usually have 4 to 6 employees. And it's funny, we got into a thing, my first shop manager happened to be a tiny gay woman.
Love
and
that.
Who was twice as strong as me and like is an incredible superhero. And it started this thing where she was so great and capable.
Yeah.
And everybody would always assume, her name is Lee, and everybody would always assume it was a guy. And we were like, oh, hey, like there's so many things that are gendered or that seem to have different gatekeepers. And so we now only hire women or gender nonconforming people just to mix it up, where it's like, you know what? The ladies are actually, the woman running the shop now is named Sarah. She's so much better of a woodworker than I'll ever be because I'm a dancing jackass flying around.
But a good one.
A benevolent, I hope. But I work as an actor, and then I get to go have fun in my wood shop where she's constantly building furniture. And so in every way, I want our public conversations to continue to break down the sensibility mm-hmm. of race and sexual identity and gender and so forth, so that everyone gets to... My friend John Hodgman, who's a very funny writer, and he has a great podcast called Judge John Hodgman. He has a mantra on his podcast where people will call in with a dispute. A pair of siblings, one of them loves Pearl Jam and one loves Taylor Swift. And the Pearl Jam one is older, so he plays his louder and longer. And Judge John Hodgman's mantra is always, you have to be allowed to like what you like. Mm-hmm. We have to stop shaming anybody for their preference. Even if you prefer smooth peanut butter instead of crunchy, I have to learn not to belittle you.
No, sorry, that's a judgment right there.
I cannot.
Yeah.
But it's not nice of me to deride you. It's not fair.
We can't yuck their yuck.
If you like to make the wrong choice, I have to let that. I have to let that happen. We have to be allowed to like what we like, and whoever you are. However you want to enjoy a national park, mm-hmm. as long as you're not doing something bad,
right.
That should absolutely be supported.
Thanks. I feel appreciated and supported.
This has gotten very blue, but I always say us dipshits got to stick together.
Thank you.
Because there are such erudite, incredible people at this festival, and I've already heard a handful of them speak. And the way that I don't get scared and run away because I feel inferior to them is that I remember we're all human. And if I sit down with any one of them, we all will probably have a story of how we screwed up something yesterday.
Yeah.
For me, it was three things, but...
that you're keeping track.
I'd be happy to share just one.
Oh, you're not gonna... Oh,
I'm not going to.
Okay, no, all right. We were all just waiting.
In that hypothetical meeting.
Oh, okay. okay, I'm going to... Is it okay if I read you a quote?
Sure.
Okay. In the end, we will conserve only what we love. We will love only what we understand. And we will understand only what we are taught. And I feel like reading this book... engaged me in a way that I wanted to learn more, and I want to read Wendell Berry, and I want to just get my hands dirty. That family that you go visit on the farm, I just want to go there and stick my hand right in that soil and like farm with them.
You know what? I've been there three times this year. We're talking about a shepherd family. Among the books I'll recommend to you, there are two by this shepherd in northern England named James Rebanks. And his books are called The Shepherd's Life and, side note, English Pastoral. He won like the National Nature Book Awards of England last year with his book English Pastoral. And it's my own publisher, Penguin Random House. His first book was a huge hit. He toured America, international bestseller. His second book, English Pastoral, is this huge hit. And they changed the title for America from English Pastoral. Now, if somebody said, listen, we think we need to change the title so Americans will feel comfortable buying this book, English Pastoral, so what do you think they would change? English. Right? No. They call it Pastoral Song. as though somehow when I'm shopping for a book, what the hell is wrong with English pastoral? Anyway, I'll die on this hill. The middle third of my book is about befriending and spending time and farming with this family in Northern England. This is the best TV channel I've ever seen. It's their Instagram feeds. He's called Herdy Shepherd, and the shepherd's wife is his wife, Helen. And they're just heroic, incredibly romantic shepherds and farmers. And the thing about spending time with them, I went there for lambing this year for a week, and you'd never even think about needing any kind of distraction or needing to entertain yourself. Right. All we do is get out in the weather and mind the sheep, and we also have cows now. I own some cows in his herd, belted Galloway cows. They're very cute and delicious. And then when it rains, we read books, and we talk about books, and we also dance and make each other laugh. And sometimes we have a little scotch, but that's like just once or twice a week. And the thing is, and it's the same with woodworking, when people ask me how to get started, you just get started. Like, yeah. Wherever you are, if you find some soil and you read some Wendell Berry or Aldo Leopold or Wes Jackson or Robin Wall Kimmerer or Barbara Kingsolver or Rebecca Solnit, you then go and look into the health of the soil that you've found and ask some questions and say, what should we grow here? Watermelons? Tulips? Blueberries? Is the right answer.
I feel like we should go get some blueberries.
I mean, we're going to.
Okay, great.
But the thing is, if you invest yourself in the health of a tiny slice of nature, it's absolutely spellbinding. Like, you'll wake up in the morning wondering if your potatoes have come up, if the garlic is ready to harvest, and so forth.
I love that.
It gets my juices flowing.
Okay, so I shared what you wrote about the Park Service with my boss, who happens to be the director of the Park Service. Like the guy who runs all 420 national parks.
Okay.
And he stood there and he said, okay, tell Nick that I'm giving him a magic wand and he can change the Park Service however he wants. So I'm giving you the magic wand from the director of the Park Service.
Thank you.
Yeah. This, listen, I'm not endorsing this, so you do you. What are you gonna do with your new powers?
I mean,
besides I think you said a septic you're gonna do a, I don't know, you're gonna do some crazy thing.
Well, I mean, I appreciate that sentiment, and I generally am pretty respectful and friendly when addressing anyone in my book with a request like, could it smell less like toilets in this certain area? And I mean, we've all experienced this, whether it's the Park Service or other municipal locations, where you arrive at something and, you know, in the infrastructure and you say, oh, no one has paid much attention to this. But here's where the questions begin. The reason I use respect and politeness and a sense of humor is because there's probably decent people on the other end of the question, and maybe they don't have the budget to allocate. Maybe the budget that would improve the septic system of this small campground went to something much more important in the park system. And so if I were given a magic wand, I would take it into a session of Congress.
Okay.
And I would sprinkle wisdom and perspicacity on that storied Tony group of people, so that they would spend less money on our defense budget and more on our relationship with Mother Nature. Mm. Who? I mean, who do we need to defend ourselves against? No one's going to take us on.
Yeah.
We've spent a lot of time and money and steroids becoming very muscular.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think we've bought ourselves some time to worry about our bridges and potholes and park sewer systems.
Yeah. Now I'm going to go out. Money is such an interesting part of this conversation. In your book, you talk about, we could save this plot of land, or we can put a business or a giant superstore.
Sure.
And the giant superstore is going to make a lot more money than that plot of land.
Yes.
And so these are the conversations we're having, and money will always win in those decisions that are being made.
It seems like it.
Yeah. And it's just, how do we engage with that well? How do we we have kind of, we're not being super nice to Mother Nature right now. We are using all of the resources in maybe not the greatest way. We are buying lots of things, maybe, I don't know. We are living our best lives without thinking about Earth living its best life right now.
I agree, and unfortunately, that's the conundrum of human nature, is that even Wendell Berry, who lives in a very frugal, nearly off-grid, simple way, even he confesses to complicity. As soon as you flip one light switch, you're part of the problem. And you know, as soon as you're not protesting the mountaintop mm-hmm. removal mining that is bringing you that electricity or whatever other ill we're inflicting upon the planet, we're all complicit. And so that is the question. Will we ever be grown up enough to take proactive measures before the lights go off, or before, something so ridiculous as our entire state says, sorry guys, no more water. if you could just not drink the water, and we're like, oh, hang on.
Right.
Shouldn't you have made sure we had water? what have, you know, we are paying a healthy amount of taxes.
Yeah.
I would hope we'd get at least water. But there's a great book. There's a wonderful writer named Elizabeth Reut. I love her books. One's called Garbage Land and one's called Bottle Mania. And they'll tell you all about how Nestle and other corporations own most of the water rights in our country, where literally the water, one of the elements.
Yeah.
It'd be like if somebody could charge you for making fire. It's being sold to us. That's why in my own dumb little gesture, I always carry this with me, because it's become de rigueur that wherever you go, they put out a plastic bottle of water, which was the invention of the Pepsi Corporation in the late 70s,
mm-hmm.
when they figured out they could make more money selling you plastic bottles than the soda that's in them. And we all are just completely complicit with that.
Yeah.
And so it's a tiny gesture, but I just try to refill my water bottle. And so I think I will, I should have saved at least 4 square feet.
Yeah, that's 4 square feet.
Of
right
the
there.
Planet.
Yeah, thank you.
Or maybe metric, could be 2 square meters. But I mean, that's the funny thing about us is we can recognize these problems. We can see the tangible results in the climate change we're experiencing. But we're still enmired in the problem. So it's going to take even greater brains than the two sitting on this stage. I think you and I can help lead the cheerleading side of
things. Oh, yeah. Pom-poms, I'm here for it.
But I'm not a great journalist or scholar, but I do love taking the ideas of great journalists and scholars and regurgitating them in a less smart way for my readership.
I thoroughly enjoyed it.
To hopefully inspire, you know, the people who will help us figure out the solution to these problems. It's going to take a lot of us.
It's going to take a lot of us. I think we have a lot of work to do. So that's okay.
Yeah, I mean, and that's something I'm thrilled to meet you, because I want to continue our conversation about how I can be a cheerleader to one of the things we can do is encourage people to vote for things that they never think about. When I read Wendell Berry and I realized I had never thought about the health of my food, I was in my mid-20s, and I was like, holy cow, we're all, that's human nature. We're happily, we love to shift into sheep mode and say, oh, great, my food is taken care of, great. And the people who take advantage of that that tendency of ours, turns out, are often interested in money.
Yeah.
More than my blood pressure.
Yeah. I can't make a lot of money from your blood pressure, sorry.
Exactly.
Well, I want to thank you for spending some time with me on stage. I think we're getting the time to ask questions from the audience, which is super exciting, because I'm sure they'll have lots of fun things to ask that I
All
can
right.
come up with. So I think someone has...
Hi, Nick.
Hello.
If you want some good blueberries, go to Maine.
Maine, thank you.
Hey.
You're welcome.
Road trip.
This isn't about your book, sorry. I really appreciated how making it brought to life and brought attention to local makers. And I just wanted to ask you how that show came to being, and will there be a season 3?
Thank you. Thank you so much. What's your name?
Sarah.
Sarah, thank you. Making It is a show that I did with Amy Poehler on NBC, and we've done 3 seasons of it. I don't know where you can see anything anymore. Peacock, NBC, Universal, Fox, 20th Century, Discovery, History Channel, Chipotle. I think Peacock is where you see it. But it's a competition show about crafting. It was Amy Poehler's idea. She and other great showbiz brains in her company, Paper Kite, had the idea for a show about crafting, and they said we should get some jerk who can swing a hammer, and she said I'd know just the guy. So it was a very lucky gig for me, and I love doing it. The company doesn't seem to think that highly of us. Every time we do the show, it seems like people really love it, but they never just renew it for another season. They wait until all their other new stuff fails, and then they call it.
Who do we need to write a letter to?
I don't know. I mean, I don't know if those things work, but. Peacock, I guess, is the seat of wisdom in this particular equation. But thank you for saying that.
Thank you.
I love to encourage everyone to make things with their hands. It's a superpower that we all have. I'm convinced everyone is great at making something. You just got to figure out what it is.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I think we're over here next.
Me? Okay. Really enjoyed the book. I went down kind of a Nick Offerman rabbit hole after that. Saw Devs, which was incredible to see you in a totally different light.
Thank you.
And we went down a national park rabbit hole, too, and ended up going out to Joshua Tree and one of my favorite national parks, Wolf Trap, for performing arts, which is right here and like no other place. Reading your book, Nick, if I may call you that. I was...
That's fine. I'll allow it.
I was really astonished by, you know, all the, obviously, the climate change concerns, you know, concerns with the earth. The chapter with the shepherd really, I really connected to the wisdom of the sheep, where they were trying to get through the stone walls, and they were like, try all the different places until they found weakness. And your obvious love of them and that life. I'm wondering when you're gonna start thinking about becoming a vegetarian.
I thank you for your question. What's your name?
My name's Heather.
Heather, thank you. I won't becoming a vegetarian. I firmly believe, and with all due respect to everyone, gets you. You may like what you like, and anyone who pursues a healthy diet, whatever that means for them, you know, more power to you. I think that a very healthy part of human civilization is sustainably raising animals for food, but we're very far. Like, the vast majority of the way we raise our animals for food is horrible. And so there's a wonderful documentary and book called Sacred Cow that's all about, the slogan is, it's not the cow that's the problem, it's the how.
Exactly.
And as soon as you introduce the word industry or like meat packing plant, anything like that is like, no, I don't want my meat to be come from an industry or go through a plant. I would agree with, I think, a lot of vegan and vegetarian philosophy when it comes to, there is no diet that doesn't kill life. Vegan and vegetarian also kill a lot of organisms. I just think we owe it to Mother Nature to do it as conscientiously as possible. And I just wanted to say, as a tangent, I meant to bring up the writer Edward Abbey, who was actually...
Never heard of him. Just kidding, yes.
You got beat me at my own game. I was like, is she kidding?
Nailed it.
He was a classmate of Wendell Berry at Wallace Stegner's program at Stanford. They had an incredible class. Ken Kesey, Larry McMurtry, and others. Gurney Norman. But Edward Abbey's, I love his sensibility in his books like Desert Solitaire or The Monkey Wrench Gang, about being in national parks or being in our public lands and loving them and wanting people to appreciate them, but not wanting them to... become too accessible.
Mm.
And that's something that's a balance that I think I sort of got off, you were asking about that, is we definitely want people to enjoy them, but limit that enough so that we don't affect the health of the park itself.
Hey, what a weird balance that we have to like walk, and I mean, the Park Service is talking about that a lot now.
But I think one salient point that he makes, I mean, I'm not. That's Potomac.
That's called protein.
One salient point that he makes is, if your feature is hiking up a mountain, don't come in and put a road to the top of the mountain,
mm-hmm.
so that people can drive up and take a Instagram moment. Like keep these journeys. If everything becomes too accessible, then we'll all turn into those fat, floating grown-ups from WALL-E who no longer know how to drive our own spaceship.
I'm not gonna knock it, though. I could float.
I could, too. That's the problem.
That's true. That's a good point.
It's okay, so yeah. Tempting
really
to, like, just be a baby, and yeah. Everyone brings me, like, my blueberry and steak
yeah.
smoothie. Sorry, did you have a question?
Yeah. Yeah, I did. You actually kind of jumped to it. I was thinking this summer Yellowstone experienced some devastating flooding. It's going to be 125 degrees this weekend in Death Valley. I grew up outside of Glacier National Park, and there are no more glaciers. And so I always saw, even visiting like Yosemite, the tension of so many people. And, you know, we feel like we have to actually experience something to value it. But in our experiencing it, we are kind of destroying a lot of it, as you were just talking about. So I wanted to kind of, you jumped ahead to my question, but is it fair then to have, I mean, how do you make it accessible? When you think about an economic or a physical or any sort of accessibility, when, you know, you do want to maybe limit the morons going through.
Right. I mean, a moron test would be great at the entrance to a lot of experiences.
Yeah, we might not make it, but still.
Right. I mean, I'll see you in the parking lot.
All right.
I would defer to you to field that question.
I have so many thoughts. Welcome to my TED Talk. There's a lot of tension in that because a lot of my work has been in diversity, equity, and inclusion and connecting communities who have not been or experienced the big, iconic national places. But that means bringing more people in, right? Mm-hmm. And then we use it more, and it's, infrastructure is not built for that, and so like this effect happens. But if we don't support a good hands-on experience, then how will someone learn to appreciate it? Mm. And the other thing is that, yes, there are people who want a very specific kind of experience in the outdoors. They want it to be quiet and meditative, and it's, you know, that iconic outdoor experience. And so when I bring more students in, then maybe that experience is broken for someone. So the Park Service is dealing with this all the time. And as you know, there are places where timed entry is now something that is happening. And then I wonder, well, if someone doesn't have the internet or access to the internet or doesn't have money, how will they know how to get in? And so I can just go down a rabbit hole of, well, I think that's why we need all the good minds to get together and figure this out together, because one person can't just do it alone.
Thank you.
Okay, I think we have time for one more question.
Yeah. Awesome. Hi, big fan. I have a question for both of you. Do you think that your personal ethos fall more within the range of a Pawnee ranger or a Pawnee goddess?
Oh, boy. Thank you for your question. What's your name?
My name is Meredith.
Meredith, thank you. And I'm sorry, I didn't ask the last questioner's name. But we will call you Champion. Park Champion. I would aspire to the ethos of a Pawnee goddess, I believe.
While I'm dressed like a ranger, also goddess. Yeah. Have you seen this?
I think basically if you can be curated by Leslie Knope or any other character, you should always go for Leslie Knope. Thank you for your question, and I am so grateful to the Library of Congress for having me here with this book that means so much to me. I'm really proud of it. I never thought I'd get to write books, and I love books, and I am so glad that I can make a small contribution to this body of work, even if it has a sense of humor to it. And I just want to thank you for having me and being gentle with me today.
Absolutely. Thank you.
Thank you.